you know, just to make a statement, is that, you know, you find a lot of times, even now, is that there's so many novices that are in places of authority. And it just seems like, you know, you see the people, and it just seems like, and you see the leadership in a lot of ministries, a lot of churches, and it's just like they don't have the heart for the people. They don't have a heart for discipleship. They don't have hearts for evangelism. And it's like the people just struggle. You know, my wife and I, we got to a point where we started calling around Bible colleges in Paris and so forth, and it's like really all you want to ask is like, where do your people go to church at? Because, you know, the churches that we have, they don't care. I mean, their agendas are so full, and it's like, what would you tell people? I mean, like, even if you get an opportunity to minister to people on the streets and so forth, it's like, you can't really refer to a church, because the one that you're attending isn't really something that's strong in the Lord. And it's like, I can't, you know what I mean? God didn't call me the pastor. That's not what I'm called to do. But the point is like, what do you do? You know, what do you tell people?
Okay. Well, there's several things I'm going to say. First thing I'm going to say is this, and I'll focus the first thing towards you in a sense, that anytime you see a need, then I believe that should motivate you to action. When you see a need, then I believe that many times, you know, when I told you I started teaching the students in preparation for ministry and how to pray for people, I did that because I saw the need. And so as I began that, boy, over time, you know, things have developed to where I'm at today and what's happening today, because there's, you know, there's a need in the body of Christ as a whole in this area, but there's a need, that's part of discipleship. So anytime you see a need in an area, I believe that when it's right strong in your heart, I believe it's almost like sometimes it's like God speaking to us, do something. If it's something you're not supposed to be doing, he'll reorder your steps, but at least you're going in a direction, you're seeing the need. So I believe it needs to start with us when we see it. And so that's the first thing. Second thing I'll say is this, that I can understand where you're coming from in the sense that I've come across people as I've traveled in many nations and many places around the U.S. and overseas that their position is where they draw their self-worth. And when you're talking about a novice, it's like it's not as much about a love for people as it is that they're drawing their self-worth from the title or the position they have. And I've seen places where they have honorary titles and just they're just almost handed out like candy because it's a way to keep people. And so, but they're not really being effective. They call themselves a minister, but they lack understanding. They're not really effectively ministering. They're not really getting effective results. They're not really discipling. So I believe there's a need there. Yes, there's that in the body of Christ, and you know, and that happens. But again, I don't think that focusing on the problem is the answer, are being critical about what others do. I don't think that's going to bring change. I believe that if we just get on fire with Jesus and start discipling and teaching others, that like a fire, it will just simply spread. And over time, people's hearts will change when they realize that, hey, they're getting godly results. And others will want it because they want what works and what gets results. I think it's just really that simple. So,
okay.
I guess to quote Forrest
Gump. God might have a church or ministry for you.
Just to quote Forrest Gump, I guess that's just all I got to say about that. So, praise God.
Okay.
Anybody else?
When you, this is just kind of, this is like a simple question. When you were out there in Karis teaching, how long did you work with? Like 10 years?
With Andrew?
Yeah.
Yeah, I was with Andrew, but I was over the area of prayer there, over the prayer center. And then while I was there, I had the opportunity to teach in the school. But when I first began to teach the students, I actually taught outside of the school because the classes were all filled up. And then Andrew came to me, and what I was teaching was where his heart was at. The Lord had been speaking to him, and he wanted to co-teach with me. But we could never coordinate it at that point. And then later, he began the Gospel Truth Seminars, and then he asked me if I would teach with him in the seminars, which was God's launching point for to release us out, you know, back in full time, heading that direction.
Cool, man.
So teaching in the colleges now, I'm not a part of this ministry. We're separate, but we're close friends. And right. and he wanted me to, he didn't want me to disappear on him. So when they scheduled me in the schools as I travel, I'm ministering churches, ministering the schools, hold seminars and conferences ourselves. And so as I travel, then I'll minister to colleges.
Did you teach like one class, like one specific thing, like multiple different topics?
I'd be getting, when I begin to teach, I start teaching in the areas where my heart was at, in this area of ministry. Because, you see, I can remember one pastor friend of mine that he's been pastoring now out of college for about 9 or 10 years. And basically, if we talk what you get when you go to college, and you, of course, you need degrees, etc. But when you go to school, you get all this information. What happens is that there are colleges that all you get is all this knowledge. You're doing the test like we do test here in our society, where if you cram and memorize all this information, then you can pass the test. But basically what happens is this, when you come out of school, you take a position, then basically you learn on the job. And you practice away. And that's been the way that it's been done for a long time. So I saw the need for the students who had callings and preparation for ministry. I saw the need to teach them how to minister as well, and then the school started incorporating it itself eventually.
Cool.
In the beginning, I started, but then it was only a matter of time until they started bringing the classes in, and then today there's a lot that Cambridge colleges are doing in these areas.
So you taught people how to apply the knowledge and get results, right, pretty much?
Yeah, I taught in the area of seeing people saved, healed, delivered, set free from bondages, baptized in the Holy Spirit, all these areas, but healing was a predominant area that I taught.
Okay, and my last question, I guess, is being that that's what you taught, which is cool,
I taught some other classes.
That's where your heart was teaching people how to apply and get results. And so, did you spend most of the time when you were in the Word just studying the four Gospels? Not that you didn't study all of it, but did you spend a lot of time just watching his life and seeing how he did things? You know what I mean? Was there any specific part of the Word that you really honed in on? Was it just
a lot of my
Gospels?
Teaching is actually very practical. So when it came to the area of healing, I started studying his life.
So the four Gospels.
If you look at the life of Christ and how he prayed for people, and then you know, I've got teaching that is coming out on the life of the apostles and such, and then into the New Testament. But you look at the Jesus, of course, the apostles. You look at the results they got. And there's reasons why. If you study the life of Christ and how he ministered and how he prayed for people, there's incredible insight. Because he got results. Yeah. But there's times Jesus experienced failure. But he wasn't a failure. In his own hometown, the scripture says he saw no mighty works. And a very minor healings manifested. But then again, look at the hearts of the people he's praying for. They were critical and judgmental towards him. They were holding him in judgment in their heart because of their natural knowledge of that area. No good thing comes out of Nazareth. You know, your mothers, your brothers, your sisters. And the wisdom, they could hear wisdom, but they were seeing nothing. But the things we've heard, they're not seeing it, but they heard. And Jesus, his response to that unbelief was that he marveled. And I believe that's a very healthy response. That's a very interesting response, the fact that he marveled. But he also did this as what we're supposed to do. There's times that you don't pray for people. They don't need prayer, even though they got physical problems. Mm-hmm. What they need is what Jesus did. He went around all the villages teaching. The intent of teaching is to take the truth of God's Word, make it so simple that a child can understand it. You elaborate on it. You continue to teach from many aspects until understanding begins to reach people's hearts, and suddenly they begin, there's a process of change, and begin to see things, life turns on. You see, while I'm ministering the Word, I've said this before, but I'm sure there's people that, while I'm ministering the Word, that the Holy Spirit is speaking things to you, showing you things, and opening up truth to you, because the Holy Spirit will be our teacher if we let him. Praise God. That's the intent of teaching. So there's times that, if you keep praying, nothing happening, there's a couple of things. Number one, it's almost like being stupid. But we don't know what we're doing sometimes in areas. It's just what we know. We operate on the knowledge we have at the time, which was the other thing I was going to say, concerning this gentleman here, what he said. It's not bad